Good morning. My name is Pieter de Visser. I work as a clinical epidemiologist at Maastricht University, Amsterdam University Medical Center and the Karolinska Institute. And the topic of my presentation today is on the spectrum of data sharing in dementia. So the outline of my talk is as follows. I will first discuss why we should data sharing, then what we need to do in order to enable data sharing, and I give some examples from data sharing initiatives in which I have been involved, from the EMIF-AD project, the Netherlands Consortium of Dementia Cohort project, and the European Platform for Neurodegenerative Diseases, which started last month. So why should we do data sharing? The obvious reason is that you increase your sample size such that you have more statistical power, and that makes it possible to detect small effects or to define subgroups. Another use of sharing the data is to replicate the findings from your own cohort in another cohort, which is more often required by reviewers of journals. And it's time and cost effective because you don't need to collect the data yourself. Still, it can take more time than anticipated, as I will show in a moment. For data sharing, you should realize that the approach is different for different types of data. So there are research data, and that means that research participants have provided consent for the use of their data in research. The other type of data are electronic health registry data, and in that type of data, participants have not provided consent for data sharing. And these are data from hospital data, routine general practitioner data, and health insurance data. So the approach of analyzing those data and share the data is different. So how should you do data sharing? First, you have to identify the cohorts that have the data that you would need for your research. So identification of data and resources. If you find a cohort and agree to collaborate, you need to set up a data transfer agreement or a material transfer agreement in the case you will share samples. If you receive the data or start to analyze the data, you need to harmonize the data across the different cohorts. And for that, you need an ontology or a mapping for a common data model. Then you can access and analyze the data, and there are different ways for that. With the research data, you can ask the data to be sent to you for your analysis and analyze and pool the data at your own site. The other approach is that the data stay locally, and that applies, for example, to EHR data sets. So the data stay locally and somebody analyzes the data at the database and sends you back the results. And a variant on that is that the data are remotely analyzed to federated access, and that the data still remain locally in the local database. So the last two options are typically used for EHR datasets, but are also increasingly used for research dataset, because then you have to avoid the problem of explicit consent for all users of data sharing. The first example I would like to discuss is that from EMIF, European Medical Information Framework, which started in 2013, was a 5-year project funded by IMI and FPI partners. So there were two aims: infrastructure aims to improve the accessibility of data in the field of Alzheimer's disease and diabetes. And there were three sub-projects, one on setting up the infrastructures, one to do research on metabolic disorders, diabetes, and one on EMIF-AD, and I was involved in the latter part. So the scientific aims on EMIF-AD was to find biomarkers for Alzheimer's disease in a pre-dementia stage, so before dementia is present, and to investigate risk factors for pre-dementia Alzheimer's disease. We developed a number of data sharing tools. First, a resource discovery, we call it the EMIF-AD catalog, and that allows you to find cohorts that have the data you would need for your research project. So cohorts that collect MRI, genetic data, and CSF data, for example. EMIF platform developed also approaches to analyze data in those electronic health registry data for which there is no consent available, and I'll give you an example on that later on. We developed a data harmonization tool for the research cohorts and also for the EHR data sets in OMOV. And we developed for the research data, we generated a platform to store the data and from which data can be shared. That was the EMIF-AD instance on Transmart. So this is an outline of the EMIF-AD catalog. So you see a listing of cohorts. We have in total 60 cohorts and 500 users that have used the catalog to find cohorts. And if you want to identify cohorts, you have here a list of different domains, cognitive tests, imaging, rating skills for anxiety, things like that. And by clicking on the different fields, you will get a list of cohorts that meet the search criteria of your request. For the EMIF-AD research cohorts, we developed a minimum data set to which we map the different variables from the different cohorts. And we stored that data set the bioportal. So we developed it using WebProtege to keep track of the changes we proposed for the different data sets. And the final ontology is on bioportal. The data platform was set up in Transmart, as I said. So here we stored the data from 15 research cohorts. They provided access to data from over 3,000 participants. And the data set contained a minimal data set of the data I showed you on the previous slide, which was harmonized. And we uploaded omics data. And I will show you which data we omics data we generated and stored. So one of the EMIF-AD sub-studies was the EMIF-AD Multimodality Discovery Study. In that study we pooled data and samples in plasma, CSF, and DNA, and MRI scans and clinical data of over 1,200 individuals across the AD spectrum from 8 cohorts. So we generated from those samples GWAS data, exome data, plasma proteomics data, plasma metabolomic data, and CSF proteomics data. And I give you one example of the outcome of that study. In this study, we took all AD patients with CSF samples available, performed untargeted proteomics analysis, and then used those protein data to define subsets of patients with Alzheimer's disease. And we found 3 what we call molecular subtypes. So type 1, in which there's an increase in neuronal plasticity proteins. Type 2, where there's an increase in proteins associated with inflammation. And type 3, where there's an increase in proteins associated with the blood-brain barrier dysfunction. So within what we call Alzheimer's disease, there are probably different forms of the disease, which likely need different treatments as well. So we use existing samples and data that had already been collected. It's an easy task, so and rather time-consuming. So we started in June 2014. So we searched the catalog for cohorts that had samples in CSF, plasma, imaging, etc. We selected finally 16 cohorts, and then it took 2 years to get all the contracts in place to share the data and the samples. And then in May 2018, we were able to generate the first wet lab analysis. So that's a period of 4 years. And well, our ambition is to improve that, make it faster in future studies. The second type of EMIF-AD was the analysis of electronic health registry data. And we made use of the Octopus and IRBOA tools developed at the Erasmus University in Rotterdam. So the data are in an OMOV data model. Data are extracted and put in a safe data environment, and the data can, with restrictions, be analyzed. But the data itself cannot be exported from the platform, only the results. So using that infrastructure, We analyzed dementia risk factors in those huge electronic health registry data. So the example on the left provides you for different cohorts with different colors, and green is the pooled estimate of the systolic blood pressure as a function of incident dementia and time before the dementia. So at this time point, patients had dementia, and then we were looking back before the diagnosis date of dementia, how the blood pressure differed between controls, is the dotted line, and 80 patients shown here with the colored line. So this gives you the difference in systolic blood pressure relative to controls. So what you can see is if you come closer to the moment of dementia diagnosis, the systolic blood pressure decreases in dementia patients, and maybe already 6 years before the dementia diagnosis. So for some reason, systolic blood pressure drops. And here we did a similar analysis with a different data set and different approach. Here we looked for different age categories and tested predictors for dementia in a 5-year interval after this age. And we see here also that hypertension was, in this case, a risk factor for development of dementia in the young age group, but no longer in the old. So then hypertension is no longer a risk factor for dementia. And we see the same for diabetes. So in younger age, it is a risk factor for dementia, and later ages, it's not. Then we move to the second initiative, the Netherlands Consortium of Dementia. It started a few years ago. And again, there were two types of aims: infrastructure aims and research aims. And the infrastructure aims was improving the fairness, so that's what we call it now, of the Dutch dementia aging cohort. Findability, accessibility, interoperability, and reuse. So these are the cohorts in different parts of the Netherlands. And we going to analyze those cohorts to identify risk factors for dementia and also different combinations of risk factors and interactions with genes, and identify risk factors for the key drivers. So these are Alzheimer pathology and vascular pathology. And this should eventually lead to an improve of design of primary and secondary prevention studies. So we have not data yet at this moment. So I briefly explained the infrastructure of the project. So in the cohorts were listed in the IMIF-AD catalog. And another element is that we now developed and implemented the personal health train, and that's a federated access tool which can also, at least in the future, perform analysis in a federated way. So we have a Docker with R scripts that are sent to the local database, with the image of a train. The R script is run locally, the data stay locally, and then the train brings back the results of that analysis. So we will start with the first case study soon. I will let you know. Okay, we also have a facility to store subject level data centrally on the Surfshire cloud, on which the data can be analyzed but not exported. So here you can merge the data yourself. We implement XNet-based storage for MR scans in the sites that collect MR scans. And we map the data in a common data format using the IMIF-AD and OMOP examples. So the final initiative I would like to discuss is the European Platform for Neurodegenerative Disorders. It started 1st of November, last month. Here you see the website on which you can find more information. So we just started, so I will discuss the outline of the study. So again, there are two types of aims: infrastructure aims and scientific aims. The infrastructure aims include the improved accessibility of data and in particular samples in order to define novel biomarkers in Alzheimer's disease, Parkinson's disease, and Lewy body dementia. The scientific aims are to, in general, discover and validate biomarkers to improve trial design, And we have a number of case studies on the amyloid tau injury markers in plasma and CSF, on complement factors, microbiome, CSF-based subtypes in AD, PD and DLB. So these are similar to the subtypes we defined in EMIF. And we will enrich cohorts with additional biomarkers or digital biomarkers if needed. So in blue you see the different cohorts. We have around 60 that are aligned to this platform and the partners. So the philosophy of EPND was not to reinvent the wheel, but to build upon existing infrastructures. So the backbone is the AD workbench. Then we added to that several data discovery tools, so the EMIF AD catalog, BBMRI catalog and EATRIS catalog. They will be integrated. And we will implement participant-level federated discovery tools and analysis tools, such as PrePET, developed in EPET, the personal health train I just discussed, and medical informatics platform here from Lausanne. And we use also existing ontologies if possible, so EMIF-AD, OMOP and CDISC, and make different choices probably for different cohorts. And we will use these tools for managing the data access, and we also will store data on ADDI workspaces. And I'll come back to that later. So we will also use SOPs developed as part of other projects, such as biomarker collection protocols developed in Biomark APD. SOPs for biobanking from BBMRI. We will apply the EOSC live data governance guidelines, and we make recommendations for minimal data sets in Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease and Lewy body dementia to support the biomarker discovery. So we still allowed that different cohorts use their own SOPs, but we try to align as much as possible, and if there are differences we will make note of that. So EPND will also use on existing cohorts, more or less by definition, and we work with a number of clinical networks and the European Alzheimer's Disease Consortium, the European Lewy Body Dementia Platform, EDLB, network of Parkinson cohorts in the UK, in Luxembourg and in the Netherlands, and a number of cohorts from DZNE. But of course, other cohorts outside these consortiums can also join. And while EPND is mainly on the discovery of data and samples, we will also host existing data and allow reuse of those data. And that will be done through ADDI workspaces that are linked to the AD workbench. So we will connect to EPET ADDI workspaces from AMIPET, it should be, and the NTK dataset. And at some point we will upload our EMIF data into this platform as well. And there will be Parkinson datasets from the Elixir node in Luxembourg. So this is how the EPND node works on the AD workbench. So this is a European hub in a way connected to the AD workbench bus, which gives access to a UK node, US node and other nodes in the future. So we have the tools here for resource discovery, for participant level discovery, for harmonizing data here with ETLs for discovery and ETLs for analysis and storage. So the data stay locally in principle, and the samples as well. So we will not have a central biobank, but could provide access to that if needed. So samples and data are identified, sent to the labs that are going to do the analysis, and we expect that the results from those analyses will be stored on the ADDI workspaces, and from there be shared with other partners. These are the consortium members, so we have expertise on stakeholder engagement and exploitation, because we aim that the platform will be self-sustainable at year 5 of the project. We have biobank and data resources from cohorts and existing biobanks. We have expertise in biobanking, sample collection and biomarker discovery, and of course expertise in setting up data infrastructures, including the Lausanne Group. So metadata discovery, federated analysis, ontology, and technical development of the platform. So you probably cannot read, but this gives a summary data of the 60 cohorts that are interested to share the data, and they provide access to this number of patients, so 40,000 controls or 30,000 AD patients, and the type of samples, CSF, saliva features, urine, and others. Okay, I would like to acknowledge the funding agencies, IMI for EMF-AD and EPND, and SONMW for the Netherlands Consortium of Dementia Cohorts, and I would be happy to answer your questions that come through the chat.